Very good afternoon, viewers. I welcome you all to the webinar series on COVID by Clinical Infectious Disease Society. This is our third webinar series. And last week we had a couple of exciting debates. And today we're going to have a three-way debate. And the topic is what works for COVID? Is it going to be those antivirals, or is it going to be the anti-inflammatory agents? Or you're going to say that, okay, nothing works, no antivirals, no anti-inflammatories, okay, leave the patient alone. So it's going to be a three-way debate. And I don't think you'll have a right answer to this current situation, because I think it's a very dynamic process in terms of what works for COVID. And for that session, we have three able ID physicians from the state of Maharashtra, which has seen the most number of cases right now in India. And probably these are three people with a vast kind of clinical experience in managing patients with COVID. And to moderate the session, I would be inviting Dr. Ram Gopal Krishnan, who is a senior consultant in infectious disease and a mentor and teacher for n number of ID physicians from Apollo Hospitals, Chennai. And in fact, he was very keen to be a part of the panelists in terms of debate, because he had a very strong view saying that nothing would work. And in fact, he was preparing his slides for that. But I think in the last 1 week, there are a lot of change in the literature. Probably we are trying some steroids or some other antivirals. So probably he himself would have had a change in mind in the last 4 or 5 days. And I would hand over the session to Dr. Ram Gopal Krishnan to moderate. He would introduce the speakers, and that, and then we could go on with the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nambi. You're trying to let the cat out of the bag, but not so successfully. So I agree, I'm a little biased in this topic, not because I like any of the speakers, but I should remain neutral till all of them have finished and then go ahead. So let me introduce all three of them first, and then we can get started. First to go will be Dr. Mahesh Lake, who's a consultant ID physician at Columbia Asia Hospital and Dinanath Mangeshkar Hospital, Pune. Second, who will be speaking in favor of anti-inflammatory is Dr. Vasant Nagvekar, well known to us, ID physician in Mumbai at Global and Lilavati Hospitals. And finally, Dr. Lakshman Jasani will be saying nothing works, who is currently at Apollo Hospitals in Navi Mumbai. So here we have three young, enthusiastic ID physicians, each proposing their point of view. Let's see who's right. The general format for this, you will get about 10 to 12 minutes to say whatever you want to say, both from the literature and from your personal experience. Then the others, after they finish, will give you a couple more minutes each to rebut or say something in addition before we throw it open for questions. Okay, so first to go will be Dr. Mahesh Lake. He will be speaking in favor of antivirals. Over to you, Mahesh.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ram. Thank you, Nambi, for and thank you, SIDS, for giving me this opportunity to speak on antivirals. And I really, feel that antivirals work. And I'm going to share some of the data which is in favor of antivirals. In the last week or so, we have got, certain data which actually really makes my point, stronger. So I'll be sharing my screen. So the discovery and the marketing of new compounds, often require months or sometimes, even years for many of the antivirals or any kind of compound, which we have seen with, a lot of antibiotics and antivirals. Now we are, feeling the crunch of it. Although there's little known about the SARS-CoV-2, several insights may be gained from its more well-known family member, that is SARS-CoV. We had, that kind of epidemic in 2003 and later on MERS epidemic in 2012. So SARS-CoV and MERS and SARS-CoV-2, they share, only 82% of their RNA sequence identity. Their RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, that is RDRP, shares around 97% sequence identity. So therefore, theoretically, the drugs targeting viral RDRP proteins for SARS-CoV-1 they should be effective for SARS-CoV-2. So this was the idea for repositioning or repurposing some of the drugs or antivirals which have been tried for SARS-CoV-1. For the RDRP target in the genus beta coronavirus, there are several potential drugs or compounds, namely favipiravir, then there is ribavirin, tenofovir, then pencyclovir, then yaldizivir, remdesivir, so and so forth. So they have been tried and tested even for SARS-CoV-2. So the predominantly my talk will be, you know, based on these some of the molecules, because they are the, you know, strong contenders or front runners in this race for the best antiviral possibly, you know, working against SARS-CoV-2. So RDRP inhibitors like remdesivir, favipiravir, and in few studies in ribavirin and sofosbuvir as well. Then there are protease inhibitors like our favorite, you know, protease inhibitors from HIV medicine, boosted lopinavir and darunavir have been tried. Then there are a few entry inhibitors like camustat, umifenovir, and you know, others are, I think Dr. Vasant is gonna talk on that. So when we see the important, you know, this is, I think, one of the important slides which I have here published in JAMA. This says, you know, SARS-CoV-2 enters the target cell through the ACE2 receptors and the transmembrane protease, serine 2, that is TMPRSS2. The TMPRSS2 inhibitor blocks the cellular entry of the SARS-CoV-2 virus through the downregulated priming of the SARS-CoV-2 spike proteins. And there is known TMPRSS inhibitors in the market like camostat, mesylate. So the learning, you know, the algorithms which have been considered based on these mechanisms, that is how these medications, you know, at different, they have this different site of action. And the machine learning algorithms on this entry pathway revealed some of the other mechanical or mechanistic properties as well. So like Janus-associated kinase inhibitors through baricitinib and imatinib as well, which I think Vasant is gonna speak on. So first of all, the front runner in these antivirals being tried in many of the COVID-19 patients across the world is remdesivir. So it can be predominantly, you know, being used in US, and it can be effectively metabolized to active nucleoside triphosphate. And so an in vitro study which has demonstrated that the nucleoside triphosphate, which works as an incorporation competitor with adenosine triphosphate, it confuses the viral RDRP and acts as a delayed RNA chain terminator against Ebola virus. So it has been tried in Ebola virus, but has not been successful in treating, you know, patients with Ebola virus infection. So recently the antiviral activity of the remdesivir was demonstrated at the stage after virus entry into Vero E6 cells, supporting its antiviral mechanism as a nucleotide analog. So with an effective reduction of pulmonary viral load in a murine model of SARS-CoV infection, potent antiviral activity against SARS-CoV-2 and acceptable safety profile, because it has been already tried in patients with Ebola. So safety is there. And a randomized trial for Ebola, so, but it not worked, but at least, you know, we have the safety. And the first case of COVID-19, which has been, you know, treated in Washington, was compassionately treated with IV remdesivir for the progression of pneumonia on day 7 of the hospitalization. So interestingly, patient's condition improved and no obvious adverse effects have been seen, and thus it has taken a front role in against the COVID-19. So this study by Grain J et al, the compassionate use of remdesivir, this is a case series. The study design was a case series, and 53 patients were those with confirmed SARS-CoV-2 infection. And patients with, you know, oxygen saturation less than 94% were taken. Average age was 64. Majority of the cases on the invasive ventilation and had comorbidity. So what intervention they have done is they have received a 10-day course of remdesivir, 200 milligrams on IV on day one and then 100 milligrams daily from day two to day 10. And there was no comparator because it was just a case series. And what are the outcomes? The cumulative incidence of improvement defined as a category improvement of a WHO ordinal scale was seen in 84%. And by last day of follow-up, that is 47% had been discharged and 13% had died. So 12 patients had serious adverse events and 4 discontinued treatment due to worsening of the pre-existing renal failure and so on and so forth. The quality of evidence was very low, but still, if you see around 25 patients, that is 47% of the patient, half of the patient actually, have benefited with this, we can say. And then next slide. Yeah. So remdesivir in adults with severe COVID-19, a randomized double blind placebo controlled multicenter trial. This was the study actually, and the study of adult patients admitted to hospital for severe COVID infection. Remdesivir was not associated with statistically significant. I think this study by Wang et al. Published in Lancet on 29th April, that has actually, was sort of, they found, no clinical benefit of remdesivir in randomized double-blinded this trial. But I think, they were too early to, publish or say anything in a hurry about this study. And the around later on, almost after I think 2 weeks, finally the preliminary report of a study that randomized more than 1,000 COVID-19 patients to receive remdesivir or placebo, and the preliminary report now published in NEJM suggests that remdesivir may shorten the time to recovery in hospitalized adults by a few days, and mortality was somewhat but not significantly lower. But it's a preliminary report, so I think we should be quite hopeful to see, some better data or coming out of this study. Then there are other drugs like boosted lopinavir, which have been tried. This is published in NEJM again by Cao B et al. And they had around 199 patients confirmed SARS-CoV-2. They have taken the patients, with already, desaturating. What intervention they have done, almost half of the patients they have given boosted lopinavir in a HIV dose, anti-HIV dose, for 14 days in addition to standard care. And there was a comparative group of around 100 patients with just standard care alone. And the outcomes of this study were time to clinical improvement. They defined it as improvement of 2 points on a 7 category or denial scale, and no difference in time to clinical improvement. So what they have seen is mortality at the 28 days was similar, but some of the patients they have recovered earlier than the standard group. So why isn't lopinavir ritonavir more effective in this study, especially if you see? The authors, chose a particularly challenging population. The patients recruited for the study were late in the infection and already had considered considerable tissue damage, which is evidenced by compromised lung function and 25% mortality in the control group. So even highly active antibacterial agents have limited efficacy in advanced bacterial pneumonia. So you need to give them, at the right time or in the early, which also, we have seen in patients with H1N1 pandemic last time, because if you use Tamiflu or oseltamivir, early in the disease, it worked well. So, and other thing is lopinavir simply isn't particularly potent against SARS-CoV-2 in this concentration. Means, basically boosted lopinavir, the dose which has been used is as it is used for HIV patients. And currently, we know little about drug concentration in the tissue where SARS-CoV-2 is actually replicating. That this trial began within days after the virus was identified, and that testing for infection was developed and deployed very rapidly, means that test characteristics had not been fully defined. So these are, I think, some of the points which have been missed in this study. Other molecule is imifenovir or arbidol, which is a broad spectrum antiviral drug, which is approved as a membrane fusion inhibitor in Russia in late 80s or early 90s, and China for prophylaxis and treatment of influenza. So the Chinese guidelines, you know, recommended it for COVID-19 according to their press release and some of the data, which is able to inhibit the replication of SARS-CoV-2 in low concentration. So they have some of the clinical data available, but however, a clear explanation for this remarkable benefit was not provided. There is preliminary report of randomized study indicating a weaker effect of imifenovir compared to favipiravir. So basically, next slide, yeah. So these medications actually, if you combine them, like we combined antivirals for treating our HIV population patients, they have combined arabidol with boosted lopinavir against the coronavirus disease, and the comparator group was just boosted lopinavir alone. So it was a retrospective cohort study with a controlled arm, though the study design or quality of evidence was low. But if you see the outcomes were a negative conversion rate of coronavirus and improvement in pneumonia by chest CT on the day 7. The viral clearance was also better in almost 75% of the patients as compared to the monotherapy group. And after 14 days in the 15 of 16 patients, respectively of 17 patients, SARS-CoV-2 could not be detected. So CT chest was improving for almost 70% of the patients. Though the number of patients were low, but given the kind of situation we are in, I think whatever data we are getting, even with this kind of study, especially combining the antivirals, is actually quite encouraging. Also, there are certain results were published by Zhu et al., and they have similar kind of things. So coming to boosted lopinavir, again, clinical efficacy of boosted lopinavir in the treatment of coronavirus disease published in European Review of Pharmacology, and it is a cohort study with controlled arm. They have taken 47 patients with COVID-19 infection, and the intervention was giving boosted lopinavir versus standard therapy. And if you see the results, both groups achieved a good therapeutic effect, actually. One second.
Mahesh, can you finish in about a couple of minutes?
So sure. So basically, the good data came from this triple combination with interferon beta, 1B, lopinavir, ritonavir, and ribavirin. So early triple antiviral therapy, which is superior to boosted lopinavir alone in alleviating the symptoms and the duration of viral shedding. So news about this favipiravir, it is another broad antiviral RDRP inhibitor. So preliminary, that means there are many studies actually coming predominantly from Japan, and the results were encouraging. Then almost 340 COVID patients were reported from Wuhan and Shenzhen as well. And what we have in India with favipiravir, there is a study which has been designed by one of the pharma company, which they are going to use favipiravir plus imifenovir, which is called as a FATE trial. I think they are going to take around 160 cases. Already they have enrolled 30 cases for us. And they have taken both kind of cases, which are late in the disease as well as early in the disease. Few data about ribavirin, but not tolerated well in many of the patients. We are going to really wait for this solidarity trial, which is going to test remdesivir, lopinavir, boosted lopinavir, then boosted lopinavir with interferon beta 1 and hydroxychloroquine. But recently we have seen that hydroxychloroquine has been asked to discontinue from this trial because of the adverse outcomes. I think oseltamivir doesn't need a mention, but some of the Indian guidelines, they have added oseltamivir as a part of their therapy initially. So with this, I'll end my presentation, and I strongly believe that if you use antivirals early in the disease, especially when they are post-symptomatic or when they are tested, positive, I think, you know, we might see a good outcome with whatever antivirals, and we should hope for the best, you know, during this difficult pandemic time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mahesh Lake. Over to Dr. Vasant Nagvekar. He'll be talking on the role of anti-inflammatories in COVID. Over to you, Vasant.
Mahesh, you'll have to...
I'm stopped.
You'll have to... stop. Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. And thank you, Sids and sir, for giving me this opportunity. After my talk, I'm sure all of you will be convinced that, you know, anti-inflammatories is the way to go ahead, because there's hardly any antivirals to work in the first week. And we are struggling, and majority of the patients coming in the second week is because of this. I'm going to start my first slide with, you know, the guidelines of how we see a COVID patient who is before he becomes hypoxic. And I'm going to share my second video where so my question is, how are you going to treat this? You're not going to give antivirals, you're saying you will not give any treatment. Are you going to allow these patients to die? I think the way forward is these patients require anti-inflammatory to be, you know, salvaging them. And we have got a fairly good experience, and I think I'm going to share all. So I think we have to understand what is happening, what's happening in the patient. Forget this incubation period, prodromal 7 days. But after 7 days, the stage 2A is a pneumonia without hypoxia. There is already inflammation started. Stage 2B is the one where your pneumonia and already there is a patient is a hypoxemic, and finally the patient goes into cytokine storm. I think what you have to do is your anti-inflammatories has to be targeted somewhere between 2A, 2B, and not allow the patient to go into stage 3. But once the patient goes into stage 3, I think you have very little window to salvage that patient. So it's very important to time your therapy of anti-inflammatories, because here, whatever antivirals, if you don't have a definitive antiviral like the H1N1, we have oseltamivir, I think if at all, remdesivir should have been tried in the first week and not after 12 days in the trial in the NEGM. So I think what you require is your anti-inflammatory timing is very, very important and should be a 2A, 2B and not in the patient when he goes into the third stage. And this is exactly what I want to tell you is that the viremia just lasts for 8 to 10 days. And after the viremia over, there is no role of antivirals. It is all the host, how the patient, how the whether it clears the virus or there is a hyperimmune response. And this is a stage where if at all the patient goes, doesn't clear the virus or doesn't, you know, doesn't be able to stop the replication of the virus, he will progress from 2A, 2B to 3C. And your role will of anti-inflammatories will come at 2A, 2B. That is very, very important. I think you have to time it very, very correctly. That is very important. If you see this pattern, we are seeing some of the patients coming in the first 3-4 days in severely hypoxic within 3-4 days and with respiratory distress. Some of the patients you will see, you know, coming, you give anti-inflammatories, they get better. And after another 5 to 7 days, they have a second surge of, again, you know, respiratory distress. And this is a biphasic fever, not seeing everybody. But we do see patients who are lingering in the ICU behaving like this. And I think you have to have a potent anti-inflammatory drug somewhere to hit it when the patient, you know, really goes bad here. I think unless you know the pathophysiology or you understand the, what is happening in the patient, you will not be bold enough to use the anti-inflammatories. You have to understand what is going in. Why is this patient behaving so badly? Unlike the H1N1, here it is something different which is happening in this patient. Unlike the you know, swine flu H1N1, you have to understand this what happened. I think Mahesh already said when the SARS infects the cells, the ACE2 and the TMPS the receptors, the virus causes the host to undergo pyroptosis and release of, you know, associated molecular patterns. What happens further is recognized by the neighboring epithelial cells, endothelial cells, the alveolar macrophages, triggering the pro-inflammatory cytokines and chemokines. And finally, two things happen. Either the host clears the virus and the inflammatory markers come down, or the what happens is because of defective immune response, there's inflammation in the lungs, brain, kidneys or sometimes even the heart. So these are the four organs which are affected, predominantly the lung, which causes a defective immune response, and there is inflammation in lungs causing a cytokine storm and multi-organ failure. I think unless we understand this pathophysiology of the inflammatory pathway, we will not be able to bold enough to use this anti-inflammatories in a clinical practice. And the potential mechanism of ARDS with SARS-CoV-2 are the inflammatory macrophages, monocytes, the IL-6, IL-10, IL-2, TNF-alpha. We are just talking about inflammatory markers after the viremia phase. And this is the stage where you have to prevent the patient to go into a cytokine storm or third. What the IL-6 does is it not only causes the local inflammation, but it causes a lot of systemic inflammation. And that is the way you land up with multi-organ failure. This is another slide which nicely explains. This is the alveolus. What happens? There is a lot of, because of the virus, the previous two slides which showed how the virus goes and attaches and releases the cytokine markers. It releases the interleukin-6, interleukin-1, interleukin-8. It causes finally the leukotrienes, platelet activating factor, procollagen, IL-8. And what it does is, it not only causes the inflammation in the endothelium, but surrounding tissue also, the alveolus and the capillaries are also involved, and it causes thrombosis. So there are two things which happen here. It's the inflammation, and finally, these inflammatory markers also cause, because of the inflammation, finally leading even to thrombosis. And I think what we require is to stop this here, the anti-inflammatory pathway, to prevent this patient, the inflammation going into a hypercoagulable state. This is a histopath where you will see the same thing, the endotheliitis and the small clots. Also, I think this paper had come, there were 5 or 6 cases reported in the NEJM where coagulopathy and antiphospholipid antibodies, again an inflammatory marker which was seen in this patient. When they tested, they found an antiphospholipid antibody because they had multiple gangrenous at multiple sites. And so the question comes, do all patients with COVID-19 who have blood clots all have this transient antiphospholipid antibody syndrome? As of now, there is a gap in the knowledge about this, and unless we have more and more data, we don't know about this. But there is definitely some association of antiphospholipid antibody syndrome also with COVID now. Now, this is the model. What I'm talking about is, which was in US by a frontline intensivist. And what they said was that if you can administer the anti-inflammatories in the emergency room when the patient gets hypoxic, you'll be able to prevent the patient in going into cytokine storm. And it's very, very important to understand this slide. This is a stage of viremia, which goes around 7 to 10 days. And once the viremia goes away, there is no role of antivirals after day 10. What they did in remdesivir trial after in NEJM was after day 12. I don't think antivirals, can you give anti-flu or oseltamivir on day 4, day 5, day 6? No, you have to give on day 1 or day 2. Similarly, I think you have to target your antivirals here. And what happens after the viremia is there, the inflammatory stage starts. And as your viremia comes down, the inflammatory stage starts. This is the time where you have to time your anti-inflammatory to preventing the patient to go into cytokine storm. It is exactly a similar model to your viral load and the CD4. As your CD4 starts dropping, your viral load goes. Something you have to target. And I think here in this COVID-19, you will have to target your anti-inflammatories at this stage to prevent the patient to go into complication or cytokine storm. So your timing is very, very important. When do you time your steroid? You can't time your steroids and anti-inflammatories in the stage 3 when the patient, you already lost the battle. It has to be in 2A, 2B stage. But many of the patients come to you in stage 3, and then that is a problem. This was a paper which has come in the allergy and immunology, which says that if your IL-6 is more than 80, or if your interleukin or your CRP is more than 97, the chances that these patients would go on the ventilator next 2 to 4 days is very, very high. So these inflammatory markers tell you that how these patients are going to behave badly, and to prevent them, I think that their treatment here would be to give an anti-inflammatory. Now, what are the various anti-inflammatories? Chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, steroids, IL-6, IgG, convalescent plasma, all these are tried. All these are experimental, and nothing is definitive and nothing is a guideline, or we cannot give as a recommendation. But all these are experimental therapies, what I'm talking about. So I think this slide has already been shown by Mahesh. What I wanted to show is this tocilizumab and all that. It binds to the IL-6 receptors, prevent the interleukin-6 release, and finally to get the patient better. Hydroxychloroquine inhibits the viral entry into the endocytosis by multiple mechanisms. So it's got some host immunomodulatory effects. I will not talk about the chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine much, but I want to talk about the other part. So coming to this paper, rationally for prolonged corticosteroid treatment in the acute respiratory distress syndrome, finally, it's a dysregulated systemic inflammation cytokine storm which happens in the COVID-19 patients stage 2, stage 3. Thus, dysregulated inflammation and coagulation observed in COVID-19 is similar to that of a multifactorial multiple medical ARDS, which ample evidence has demonstrated the ability of prolonged corticosteroids to downregulate the inflammation, coagulation, proliferation, and accelerate the disease resolution. Additionally, the CT findings of ground growth opacities and the histological findings of hyaline membrane and inflammatory exudates are compatible with corticosteroid-responsive inflammatory lung disease. If you do a postmortem, you'll see the lungs are inflamed and heavy compared to the weight. Normal weight would be around, say, 1 kg. When you have a postmortem, the weight of the lungs is almost 3 to 4 kg. So why is the WHO giving against this? Why is WHO against giving corticosteroid? The WHO statement of not recommending the routine use of corticosteroids for treatment of viral pneumonia outside clinical trials relies on incomplete evidence. If the evidence favors the use of corticosteroids, if WHO says that there favors evidence for corticosteroids in non-viral ARDS, why it is saying no in COVID? So why does WHO not recommend corticosteroids for COVID-19 associated ARDS? The reason is, the WHO's brief argument to support the recommendation is mainly based on the risk of decreased viral clearance reported in one observational study. Where we are talking about viremia, we are talking on giving this therapy on day 7, day 10. We are not talking the first 7 days. And inconclusive evidence from retrospective observational studies without a pre-designated study protocol and subjected to co-founding imbalance in baseline, characteristics and hidden biases. What kills COVID-19 patients, we have to understand, is the dysregulated systemic inflammation. There is no evidence linking delayed viral clearance to worsened outcome in critically ill COVID-19 patients. And it is unlikely that it would have a greater negative impact than the host's own cytokine storm. So this is a protocol. What we are also following is, given if the patient's requirement is the saturation less than 94, we give solimeterol 40 to 80 milligram, and if the oxygen required is more than 4 liters, we give around 80 BD or 60 BD. I'm not going to talk about chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine as an anti-inflammatory because I want to talk about other things. Coming to the tocilizumab, it's an IL-6 inhibitor and the dosage is anywhere from 400 to 800. Maximum dosage is around 800 milligrams to be given. So how does it? So these are the other influences. So role of, let us see what is the evidence for corticosteroids in COVID-19. There's so much of literature, but because I've just got 15 minutes, I wanted to talk about other anti-inflammatories. I just pulled one or two references. So role of corticosteroids in COVID-19 literature search. This was from China. A retrospective observational single study in 201 patients with confirmed COVID-19 pneumonia who developed ARDS, methylprednisolone appeared to reduce the risk of death. Among patients with ARDS, of those who received methylprednisolone, the mortality was 46% compared to 62% on those people who did not receive methylprednisolone. So there is a clear cut, you know, benefit. But again, the timing is very, very important. If you give it early, possibly it would be much better. So this is a paper which everybody would like from CIT. I think early short post corticosteroid hospitalized patient. This is coming from Henry Ford and by Pallavi Bhargava, George Alagadan, and Mayur Ramesh. And what it talks about is, what it said is, before the era of before March 20, it was a standard of care and the outcomes of standard of care versus corticosteroid treatment were evaluated with the primary endpoint of how many patients they could prevent getting into the ICU or mechanical ventilation. So they analyzed 213 eligible subjects, 81 that is were given steroid and 132 were given standard of care. What they found is they could prevent the patients going into the ICU or mechanical ventilation in 35% of the patients in compared to 54% in the standard of care. So conclusion of this study, which is going to get published in the Clinical Infectious Disease CID paper, is an early short course of methylprednisolone patients moderate to severe COVID reduced escalation of care and improved clinical outcome. And this is exactly what I want to tell you. The moment the patient starts getting desaturated, possibly there may be a role of an anti-inflammatory coming into picture. I think we require more randomized control trial to say this. And this is another paper which talks about risk factors of ARDS in COVID-19. And clearly there was those people who did not receive methylprednisolone and who received methylprednisolone, there was a definite benefit seen in people who received methylprednisolone. This is a rational use of tocilizumab in the treatment of novel coronavirus pneumonia because it blocks this SL3 and GP130 and all that. I'll not go more detail into that, but it's an interleukin 6 inhibitor, and that is what we know about this. If you see the life story of tocilizumab right from 1956 coming down to 2020, you'll see tocilizumab is trial in COVID-19 pneumonia. Blue means it is phase 3 clinical trial. So there are a lot of hopes, and I think more and more trials, randomized control trial, will confirm in as the COVID-19 goes how effective
these antigens are. Last couple of minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, last couple of minutes, Vasant.
Yeah. Yes, sir. So these are the various criteria for getting the tocilizumab into the picture. I think I'll not go into detail about this. One more slide about impact of tocilizumab in the COVID-19 related pneumonia, where the patients who were received were patients who had a respiratory rate of 30 or saturation less than 93 or PAFI-to-TT ratio was less than 300. What they found is that 2 out of 62 patients of the tocilizumab and 11 out of 23 in the control group, you know, that is 92% of the patients in the tocilizumab could be discharged, whereas only 42% in the control arm could be discharged. So that is the impact of these anti-inflammatory in this. Another paper of tocilizumab, which talks about a single study of 100 patients in Brasilia, Italy, which talks about that among of the 43 patients treated in ICU, 74% of the patients improved. And in the ward, almost 65% of the patients who could not get a bed in the ICU got improved with tocilizumab as an anti-inflammatory in second week. There are these various other anti-inflammatories, which I will not go into this. The other ones are itolizumab, colchicine, etrubinin, ibrutinib. So itolizumab is another anti-CD6 inhibitor, which not only downregulates IL-6, but it downregulates TNF-alpha. And I think we may have to look at itolizumab also in the treatment. In our study at Global Hospital, we had 140 patients, 84 discharged. Tocilizumab, 12 patients have been given. 4 patients expired, intubated. Out of 4 patients, 3 got extubated, discharged to an ICU. There are 2 patients still there in the ICU. We found that the response was around 70%. And the patients who expired, our experience is that we gave them very, very late. That is in the third stage, when the requirement of oxygen was 100%. We have got better off now giving early treatment. Among the methylprednisolone group, around we gave 7 people who died here. We had around 7 mortalities, over 140. 39 of them, all of them received methylprednisolone. 14 have been discharged, and the rest of 18 are still on treatment and still better, doing well. The convalescent therapy, which I don't want to go into, and this is the last slide, which I want to show is that.
So, Vasant, can you stop here? We give Lakshman a chance to talk. Then you can take up more stuff later.
Yes, sir. Fine. So in conclusion, this is a critical moment. This is a patient. The previous slide was of where IL-6 was not high, only the CRP was high. So should we consider that? So in conclusion, there is a critical moment for the world in which even industrially advanced countries have rapidly reached ICU saturation and intensives are forced to make difficult ethical decisions. Steroid IL-6 cannot be a recommendation or guideline, but clinically an individualized consideration should be considered. Thank you for it.
Okay, thanks, Vasant. Over to Dr. Lakshman Jasani. He'll be talking on nothing works for COVID. Over to you, Lakshman.
I'll just share the screen. A very good afternoon to one and all, and I like to thank the SIDS for giving me this opportunity. Well, friends, two of my colleagues, Dr. Mahesh and Dr. Vasant Nagvekar, has given a very passionate talk on antivirals and on anti-inflammatories. But friends, I would like to reiterate the same point. Have they provided sufficient evidence whether the antivirals and anti-inflammatory, do they work? And friends, from my side, I will give you some evidence to show that the antivirals and anti-inflammatory do not have any significant evidence to be used. My aim would be against giving a punch back to the antivirals and the anti-inflammatories. And over the next 12-14 minutes, I'll try to provide the evidence that nothing actually works. Let us start with the recommendations from the various bodies. Have a look at what WHO says. The WHO says that drugs not to be administered as treatment or prophylaxis include chloroquine, hydroxychloroquine, antivirals like lopinavir, remdesivir, favipravir, and including steroids and tocilizumab and interferon beta gamma. What does CDC say? CDC says that there is no drugs or therapeutics presently approved by US FDA to treat COVID-19. What does the NIH say? The NIH says as well that there are no FDA approved drugs for the treatment of COVID-19. So all the major bodies say that there is no particular drug which is effective for COVID-19. None of the antivirals and none of the anti-inflammatories. Let me have a look at some of these investigational therapies and let me provide you the studies which suggest so. I present my first argument, the chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine with or without azithromycin does not work. And why do I say that is because of this study. This was a study which compared low dose versus high dose chloroquine, which was a randomized double-blinded study among severe COVID patients. But the study was stopped by Data Safety and Monitoring Board after the patients were enrolled into the study. There was a distribution of 41 and 40 patients respectively in the high arm and the low dose arm. Overall fatality was 27.2%. But friends, please note, mortality by day 13 was higher in the high dose arm as compared to the low dose arm. And look at the QTc prolongation. That was also much higher as a high dose arm. What was the interpretation of this study was that despite the small number of patients enrolled, this study raised concerns for increased mortality with high dose chloroquine associated with azithromycin and oseltamivir as well. Let me talk about hydroxychloroquine. So this is a study which compared hydroxychloroquine with the standard of care. And this was a multi-center randomized controlled trial, 75 patients in each arm. And the primary outcome was to look at the negative PCR at the end of 28 days. So what did the result show? The result showed that there was no difference found between both the arms to negative PCR conversion within 28 days, no difference in time to negative PCR conversion. There was no difference in the rate of symptom alleviation between the two groups, and adverse events occurred in 30% of the patients in the HCQS arm. What was the interpretation of this study? The study demonstrated no difference in the viral clearance between hydroxychloroquine or the standard of care. Let me show you another study in which they combined hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin. It was a retrospective observational cohort study of 368 patients in which there were three arms, hydroxychloroquine, hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin, and no hydroxychloroquine. And this was the distribution of around 100 odd patients in each arm. What they observed, there was no difference which was observed between the groups in the risk of mechanical ventilation. Risk of death from any cause was much higher in the hydroxychloroquine arm compared to the other arm. And the final interpretation of the study showed no beneficial effect of hydroxychloroquine plus azithromycin for the treatment of COVID-19 and possibly an association of hydroxychloroquine with increased mortality. Another study of hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin, this was a case series of 84 patients where they looked into the QTc prolongation. And they noticed that 11% of the patient developed QTc prolongation more than 500 milliseconds. This case demonstrated hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin in combination can prolong QTc, and that combination warrants careful monitoring. And then friends, this is the paper from NEJM which showed that hydroxychloroquine is not that beneficial. And more recent paper from Lancet, which has actually come in last couple of weeks, and they showed hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine with or without a macrolide caused increased risk of hospital mortality, and there was an increased risk of de novo ventricular arrhythmias due to this combination. And what was the final conclusion? Each of these drugs was associated with an decrease in hospital survival and an increase in the frequency of ventricular arrhythmias. And as a result of this Lancet paper, the CQS arm of the WHO solidarity trial has also been stopped. So this arm has completely been stopped in the solidarity trial on the basis of this evidence. So I have convinced you, I guess, regarding CQS and chloroquine that it is not that beneficial. Let us see what is the recommendation by the NIH. There is insufficient clinical data to recommend either for or against the use of chloroquine or CQS for the treatment. The COVID-19 treatment guideline panel recommends against the use of high-dose chloroquine. The combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin associated with QTc prolongation, and the panel recommends against the use of HCQS plus azithromycin except in the context of a clinical trial. Let us move on to the second argument. My second argument is that lopinavir, ritonavir does not work. Why do I say so? is because of this study which compared lopinavir, ritonavir versus the standard of care. It was a randomized controlled trial involving 199 patients. And what they found? They found a lower but not statistically significant mortality rate for lopinavir, ritonavir. Shorter ICU stay, yes. The duration of the hospital stay but was same in both the groups. The time to clearance of viral RNA from the respiratory tract did not differ in both the groups. And the side effects of lopinavir, ritonavir, like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, were more frequent in this particular group. What this trial suggests? A moderate-sized randomized trial failed to find a virological or a clinical benefit of lopinavir, ritonavir versus the standard of care. And what does the NIH recommend? The panel recommends against the use of lopinavir, ritonavir or any other HIV protease inhibitors for the treatment of COVID-19, except in the context of a clinical trial. My third argument is, does remdesivir work in all COVID patients? I think Dr. Mahesh had shown remdesivir works. Let me show you a trial where I can show you remdesivir does not work. And this is a randomized controlled trial from China where 237 patients with severe COVID were given remdesivir versus a placebo. And what did they find? They found no difference in the time to clinical improvement between the remdesivir and the placebo group. Similar mortality rates were found in both the groups. There was no difference between the groups of the viral load at baseline, and the rate of decline over time was also similar in both the groups. More participants in the remdesivir arm than in the placebo arm discontinued treatment because there was a lot of adverse side effects. What are the adverse side effects? You can have GI side effects, elevated transaminases level, elevated prothrombin time elevation, and not to forget, there is an increased increased risk of renal failure because there is a cyclodextrin ring in the remdesivir which increases the risk of renal failure. What is the recommendation? Remdesivir is not approved by the FDA. Overall, remdesivir likely to have some clinical benefit, although the patient population most likely to benefit is uncertain. That means in all patients, remdesivir cannot be given. Remdesivir can be given only to one subgroup of the patients, and this subgroup of the patients will be those who have a saturation less than 94% on ambient air, requiring supplement oxygen, mechanical ventilation, or an ECMO. But the recommendation is not for the treatment of mild to moderate COVID-19, where remdesivir should not be given. So friends, again, remdesivir is not your one drug for all. You have to select the particular group of patients where remdesivir can be given, and it cannot be given to all patients of COVID-19. Now let me come with my fourth argument regarding the corticosteroids. I think Dr. Vasant Nagvekar elaborated the use of corticosteroids and how it helped in decreasing the inflammation. But let me show you a few studies which show that corticosteroids can actually be harmful. So friends, this is an evolving study subject, and there are very few studies on corticosteroids for COVID-19, let us go through of those. Let me start with the WHO recommendation. As Dr. Vasant Nagvekar had said, the WHO does not recommend the use of corticosteroids for COVID-19 or any other viral pneumonia. And they say, given the lack of effectiveness and possible harm, routine corticosteroids should be avoided unless they are indicated for other reason, for example, shock or in ARDS. Let me show you the study which was impact of corticosteroids on the outcome of persons with SARS-CoV-2, SARS-CoV and MERS-CoV. So they did a systematic review and meta-analysis by Lee and his group. And what they found is corticosteroids did not reduce the risk of death, did not reduce the hospital duration, did not reduce the ICU admission rate, did not reduce the use of mechanical ventilation. And moreover, corticosteroids had several adverse effects as well. Now, this is another study by Zha, which was an observational study, where COVID-designated hospitals in Wuhan were given corticosteroids. 11 of the 31 patients received corticosteroid treatment. And what they found is no association between corticosteroid treatment and the virus clearance time. The study also found no association between therapy and outcomes in patients without acute respiratory distress syndrome. Another study by Fang et al. Showed low-dose corticosteroids does not delay viral clearance. So of all these studies, even the IDSA has come with a recommendation among patients who have been admitted to the hospital with COVID-19 pneumonia, the IDSA guideline panel suggests against the use of corticosteroids except in ARDS. And this is a systematic review of observational studies in influenza, where they used corticosteroids in influenza, and they found there was a higher risk of mortality and secondary infections with corticosteroids, and you can extrapolate the same thing for COVID-19. What is the recommendation by the NIH? The panel recommends against the use of systemic corticosteroids for the treatment of mechanically ventilated patients. mechanically ventilated patients with ARDS, there's insufficient evidence to recommend for or against the use of corticosteroids. Adults with COVID-19 and refractory shock, the panel recommends low-dose corticosteroids for refractory shock, but the panel recommends against the use of systemic steroids for the treatment of COVID-19 in hospitalized patients unless they are in intensive care unit. So most of the recommendations are against the use of corticosteroids. Now, friends, this is a study which Dr. Vasant Nagvekar had presented, which was by Mayur Ramesh, Pallavi Bhargav, and George Alangadan. But friends, this study was very exciting study because the study showed that early use of corticosteroids probably is beneficial and has an anti-inflammatory effect. But friends, Vasant probably did not go in detail of the paper because the paper had certain limitations. What were the limitations? There was differences in the baseline characteristics of both the comparator groups. Some of the standard of care group experienced delayed diagnosis and treatment. Guidelines adherence in the early corticosteroid group was not universal and there may have been subject to channeling bias. There was a limited follow-up period of 14 days and may be subject to lead time bias. So this was not a perfect paper. So we have to take this study with a bit of a pinch of salt. And finally, my last argument is regarding the immune-based therapies. Friends, again, there are very few studies on the immune-based therapy. Data supporting the use of convalescent plasma for COVID-19 are limited to a small retrospective cohort study, small case series. There are not many studies on it. There is insufficient data to recommend either for or use of convalescent plasma or SARS-CoV-2 immunoglobulins. And the COVID-19 panel recommends against the use of non-SARS-CoV specific IVIG for the treatment of COVID-19. Now, let me show you a study of tocilizumab with the standard of care. Dr. Vasant Nagvekar showed that how tocilizumab may be beneficial, but let me show you a study where tocilizumab was compared with the standard of care and they looked into the terms of ICU admission and mortality rate for critically ill patients with severe COVID-19. This was a retrospective analysis by the SAMACOR registry. This was a study which was done in Italy and tocilizumab was given to 21 patients. Using the propensity score, 21 patients who received tocilizumab were matched to 21 patients who did not receive tocilizumab and but they were received the standard of care, which was the use of hydroxychloroquine, azithromycin and low-dose heparin. What did the study find? The study found after giving tocilizumab did not significantly affect the ICU admission. It did not significantly affect the 7-day mortality rate. The conclusion is tocilizumab administration did not reduce ICU admission, nor did it reduce the mortality rate in this study by Colonnari and group. So my final slide, friends, is that there is insufficient data to recommend for or against the use of any of these anti-inflammatories like interleukin-1 inhibitors like Anakira, interleukin-6 inhibitors like tocilizumab, and except in the context of clinical trial, the panel does not recommend the use of interferons and including Janus kinase inhibitors, which Dr. Vasant Nagvekar showed. Friends, I have given you 5 arguments, and based on these arguments, no single treatment have proven to be effective. And friends, we need more data, we need more studies to show that these treatment actually work. Friends, I would like to say, what is the evidence, friends? Show me the evidence and I will be in favor of using these agents. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Lakshman. So we have a minute or two for each of the other panelists. We'll ask Dr. Mahesh to go first. Anything you want to add, Mahesh, based upon what the others said?
Yeah. See, basically, can you just unshare your...
I've stopped.
Just make it quick, so we'll have a couple of minutes for each. So.
See, I'm with Lakshman when he says, you know, HCQs and steroids don't work. But when he says, you know, remdesivir doesn't work, he has shown that paper by Wang et al. So I have given already that answer because it was, you know, hurriedly, you know, taken into a press note that it doesn't work and all. But finally, we have this preliminary report of a study that randomized, you know, more than 1,000 COVID-19 patients to receive remdesivir or placebo, and it is showing, you know, remdesivir works if it's given in an early phase of, you know, viral infection and if you choose the patient rightly. The other argument by Lakshman was, you know, about lopinavir ritonavir doesn't work. But, you know, let me tell you, friends, you know, because the authors, already I have shown that the authors, you know, chose a particularly challenging populations, you know, already these patients were on ventilators and seriously ill and all. And secondly, lopinavir simply isn't particularly potent against SARS-CoV in a given concentration, which has been used for HIV. And what can I say about Vasant's, Vasant, you know, politically has brushed upon the hydroxychloroquine, and slowly, you know, he has run away from saying anything about hydroxychloroquine. But I think Lakshman has taken, you know, into account all those things against the hydroxychloroquine. So about steroids and tocilizumab, let me tell you, friends, the hypothesis that Vasant was giving about the, you know, anti-inflammatory effect and all. But all the authors which have done these studies on various agents like steroids and tocilizumab, they have less, they were also less enthusiastic and urge caution and pass at them to block the cytokine storm associated with the other microbial infections with the sepsis have not been successful and in some cases have worsened the outcomes. And that is why, you know, even IDSA and even American Thoracic Society, these all guidelines, if you see, you know, past experiences with flu and other pneumonias, they always say that don't use steroids. Because later on, we have seen in flu patients, you know, people have been using steroids left, right, and center. Later on, you know, they land up in, you know, aspergillosis and, you know, various kinds of difficult to treat bacterial and fungal pneumonias. That's why I think we should not, we should be very cautious when we are, you know, saying that steroids should be used. And moreover, there is a concern that, you know, suppressing the innate and adaptive immune system to address the increased cytokine concentration could enable unfettered viral replication, which suppress the adaptive immunity and delay the recovery process. So I think, you know, using steroids and fancy molecules like tocilizumab, again, should be very, we should be very cautious about that. And anyways, the WHO Solidarity trial is going to give us a very you know, good data about the remdesivir. So I just,
we're running out of time. Can I ask Vasant?
Yeah. So I just want to this thing, Vasant. Means, are you going with the same argument when you, when we don't have the diagnosis, say sepsis, when we don't have the treatment, say steroids?
Okay, over to you, Vasant. Anything you want to add?
I just want both of Lakshman and Mahesh to see very carefully this slide. Okay, so this is a patient who came on day four. Day four, he has come to the hospital and he's severely hypoxic. Please see properly the CT scans. Okay, now Mahesh and Lakshman, what do you want to do? You want to give him oxygen or put him on the ventilator and pray to God to get him cured from coronavirus? Is this what you want to say? The first argument again, Mahesh is, against Mahesh is that he's saying aspergillus and fungal infection. If the patient survives, then he'll develop aspergillus. If you allow this patient to live on oxygen, he's not going to, he will never get aspergillus. Second argument is that you are talking about viremia. See, the viremia is over in the first week. Don't talk about nothing, steroids, nothing to do. I am talking about giving steroids in the second, that is 7 to 10 days, then the viremia is already over. So why are you talking about viremia here? And the third about Lakshman, he himself has answered my question. IDS is very, very smart, you know, is diplomatic. What his first statement is saying that do not use corticosteroid, but use it in AIDS. When the patient becomes hypoxemic, what does it mean? That means it's AIDS, you know. So it's very diplomatic, saying that do not use corticosteroids, but use it in AIDS patients. Okay. Second is that use it, do not use early, but use it late. Okay. Third is NIH is saying use it, do not use routinely, but use it in a critically ill patient. I'm saying if you use in critically ill patient when the cytokine is, then I think there you can pray to God. What I'm saying is you have to use it in stage 2A, 2B to get your patients correct. That is very, very important. Second, about tocilizumab. They are saying use tocilizumab. Lakshman is saying in critically ill patient. I'm saying don't make the patient critical and then use tocilizumab. I'm saying use it at the correct time. You have to hit it correctly, not in the first week, not in the third week, to get your patient better. Okay, not the patient, no, not to make the patient critically ill. Okay, so that's all from my side.
So my last question to Lakshman is, you know, is he going to think about all these options, Lakshman?
Yeah, I'll just give a quick rebuttal. For Mahesh, in his presentation, he showed a study by Gren et al., which use remdesivir. But in that study, he himself noticed that there was a higher number of renal failure in patients who were given remdesivir, and 12 patients had serious side effects in that particular study. And another study he showed for remdesivir was Wang et al., which did not show any benefit. So I think these are the two studies which show that remdesivir probably need to be used with caution. And umifemovir, which he showed, again, there was no data much about it. Moreover, no much data about lopinavir, ritonavir. So I think antivirals, probably remdesivir has some role, but where to place it in treatment, we need to find that out, and probably we need more studies with that. And my rebuttal to Dr. Vasant Nagvekar, yes, probably we are going to see the use of early use of steroids, maybe in the inflammatory stage, but probably we are not yet at that stage to know it. So I think once we have a few more studies which show that we can use steroids, we will use steroids with confidence. But probably this is something we have to look into it. Probably we will use steroids more and more for our patients.
Okay. Okay. So now that all three of these very vocal Maharashtrians have had their say and saying totally different things, so I wonder what the poor state of Maharashtra is going to do. Who are they going to follow? So let's just try and summarize and work out a general guideline for all the viewers who are watching this. So let us start with the antivirals. The hallmark of any therapy for it to be proven to work or for it to be recommended for us to use it is the randomized clinical trial. And for in terms of randomized clinical trial data, the only drug that has, the only antiviral that has that is remdesivir. A couple of updates on remdesivir. The recent New England said that 5 days is as good as 10. But remember, remdesivir did not help patients on the ventilator. So the really sick ones, like the CTs Vasant presented, it doesn't help those patients. So that's a problem with this drug. We also know it's an expensive drug. We don't know when it will come to India. All the other drugs that were discussed, say lopinavir, ritonavir, favipravir, umfenovir, all these drugs really are, you know, searching for diseases or indications. We need much better data. And I think it's safe to say that hydroxychloroquine really should not be used for treatment of COVID. For prophylaxis, that's a different issue, but for treatment, multiple studies are against that. Regarding anti-inflammatories, the data presented by Vasant in terms of low-dose steroids is certainly very promising. The problem with that study is that it used historical controls. The controls were from 2 weeks earlier when they were using a different antiviral regimen. They were using lopinavir, ritonavir at that time. So there are multiple confounding factors in that study. However, given the fact that steroids are cheap, given the fact that they timed it early, I think most people would accept that till we get better data, we probably should be using steroids in that dose they recommended within 2 days of worsening hypoxemia or 8 days of onset of symptoms, exactly as they did in the trial. Regarding the other anti-inflammatory drugs, you know, CTs are fine, but the issue is, would the patient get better on their own or with an anti-inflammatory agent? Certainly, tocilizumab is available in India. You can use it. But again, no randomized controlled trial data. So really, at this point, it is very difficult to say uniformly use it. Perhaps in a sick patient, based upon your bedside instincts, perhaps you can use it. But among all the anti-inflammatories, it's the only one that that you know we have readily available in India. So all guidelines remain fixed. They say, you know, don't just do something, stand there. That is what most guidelines say. People know, we are having studies ongoing, but nothing to beat good supportive care. In my opinion, all those patients in Vasant's ICU would have gotten better with good supportive critical care, whether they got drugs or not. So this was a wonderful debate, gentlemen, for presenting all these papers and points of views. Hopefully we would have guided our Indian clinicians on how to use these new drugs. And please watch this literature soon. I'll hand this back to Dr. Nambi. Thank you once again for joining and for sharing all that literature with us. I'll hand this back to Dr. Nambi and Sids.
Thank you, sir.
I think that was a very good debate. And thanks, Dr. Mahesh Laki. Thanks, Lakshman. And thanks, Vasant. I don't think there is any clear right answer. Probably we have to go with the temporal profile of the illness. Probably some drugs may work. And in most of the situations, I don't think you would need a drug in most of the situations, most of the patients. But in a sick hospitalized patient, I think it's for a debate. We can do so many things. But in a sick hospitalized patient, supportive care is there. But if there is an app antiviral available, probably most of us would try using it. So it would be an anti-inflammatory agent, let it be steroid or other drugs. But with respect to COVID, what we have learned is we know very, very less. probably what we are aware is we do not know much, and that gap between what we think we know and what we do not know is getting bigger with COVID day by day, and that's the challenge. And then perhaps we can debate on this topic 2 months later when we have much more Indian literature or Indian data. Perhaps we could have something saying that some antiviral is working or some anti-inflammatory is working or nothing works, as Dr. Lakshman pointed out. Probably I also believe in that nothing works and nothing is required in most of the patients. Probably a minimal subset of patients, hospitalized ICU patients, may require drugs. And that would be the end of this debate. And thank viewers for joining in on an afternoon. And we would be having a series of short lectures tomorrow. And the topics would be on appropriate PPE use, or it could be on the healthcare worker COVID exposure risk assessment. That is a problematic thing with respect to infection control, because what do we do with our exposed healthcare workers? When do they get back to work? Do we test them? Do not test? So those are real practical questions that we have. And again, PPE, most of us know this word, but unfortunately, most of us are not trained to use this. And that is something that Dr. Rajalakshmi would be speaking on. Of course, the diagnostics. So what do we do with the PCR? What genes should we look for? Where does those antibody kits, are they still lying in China, or are we going to have in India? And these are the mini lectures that we will have tomorrow. And all these lectures are available in our website, www.sidsindia.org, which also has literature relevant to the COVID scenario. And the people who could not watch the live action could always go to the YouTube channel, and then all they have to type is CIDS, SIDS webinar, and they could have access to all the content, the previous two editions plus the current ones. I thank once again for all the participants, and of course, the moderator, Ram Gopal Krishnan, for keying in and then giving his final verdict. And I think his practice is changing, that I've seen in the last 5 days. Probably in 2 weeks, he may have a different thing towards the whole day. Thank you. Thank you, viewers. And we will see you again tomorrow afternoon, again at 3 p.m. Thank you.
Thank you, Nambi. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Mahesh. Thanks, Vasan. Yeah. Thanks, Lakshman.